Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Wow, no performance anxiety after that intro. Very excited when I swam up from Melbourne this morning to be here, and I thank you all. I know it's been a terribly difficult time to get here, so on behalf of AIA and myself, thank you very much for finding your way through all the water to come in here. I'm really quite excited for a couple of reasons. One of them is that I'm not speaking last, as what I usually do, and I usually get the chance to speak last. After everyone's had lunch, they're all bored out of their brains, they've had a big meal. So I usually see a sea of bobbleheads just trying to stay awake when my time is coming. A few little dribble marks. Last year I was asked to go around Australia to make a series of talks. And they had this evil thing called a feedback form. And I was curious to know what sort of feedback it is, because I usually get asked very, very technical presentations. It needs to be quite dry in some regards, and I don't particularly like it. Pina said to me, oh, you did pretty well, and I had a little look at it. And they rate you excellent, good, adequate. Adequate, what a terrible word. 4P, I was mortified to find people thought I was adequate. It's not a term I've heard since my first girlfriend, but I would hopefully like to have you all interact with me so we don't have another adequate performance. If you want to put your hands up, please put your hand up and one of our lovely staff members over here will bring the mic just so the rest of the people around you can actually have a little chat. As Vicky actually said, I came into insurance without having any insurance background really at all. So it's been a real eye-opener for me. In fact, a lot of my colleagues thought I was moving to the dark side, obviously, to move out of clinical medicine. And not that this is a pre-scripted corporate love fest, but I really have to say that I have been absolutely impressed with my claims colleagues, my underwriting colleagues, and my sales colleagues, apart from everyone else in the business. They really do try to do the best they can. It is not an easy position to be in as the chief medical officer there. I don't have people actually respect my opinion. No, they do respect my opinion. They just come and challenge me all the time saying, why can't we do this? Why don't we do this? What if we do something else? And I think that's really important. That's totally a external perspective of it. I was quite impressed. I still am impressed. I had a very warm welcome when I actually started at AIA, and I'll just recount one very amusing anecdote before we get into this. I was in the lift going up to the AIA floors, and there was another gentleman from Indian background, a suntan blessed colleague of mine, and he looked at me and he said, you work at AIA? And I said, yeah, I do. It's my first week here. And he had a really puzzled look on his face. And he goes, but I haven't seen you in our IT department. What do you do here? So went home that night to my wife. She says, how's the new job going? I said, great people, but it's a really weird career path I'm coming into. I'm going to do a talk on this heart attack definitions for crisis. Now, we came up with this topic several months ago, and there's obviously been some movement in the market recently. So if anyone feels the need to ask me questions specifically about it, please do. I'm going to try and do a couple of things over here. One of them is the technical side of things, which is this is what a heart attack is. But I'm also going to try and give you a bit of an insight as to how cardiac definitions or any sort of crisis definitions are constructed. Because, you know, ultimately, I'm going to throw it over to you. Who here feels comfortable with crisis definitions? Who feels that they've got a really good handle as to what a crisis definition is, how to be able to compare somebody to... Thank you very much. One brave gentleman who's going to be picked on for the rest of the 40 minutes.
I'm probably a good person because I actually, as the agent and claimant, I was the agent and
claimant. I'm sorry, do you mind just saying that again?
I'm probably a good person to be able to put my hand up because I'm both a reasonably unique situation, an agent and a claimant.
Oh, wow.
5.5 years ago... 19th of October 2006, I had quadruple bypass surgery, a claim with AIA, which was paid fantastic, and thanks, I've already said it before, but thanks to AIA, but I do have a good handle on trauma definitions.
Thank you very much for sharing that, I really appreciate that, that's great. This is why I like the heart attack definition talk rather than the prostate cancer talk. We'd have a line of men after my talk who's asking about their prostates. I'm going to give this for the rest of you who maybe don't have as much exposure and understanding. I do want to go and show you what definitions are made of, just so you can compare. There's obviously rating houses. I find this quite challenging. This is a very, very technical aspect. And it must be very challenging for you to read it and look at it, and a lot of it makes no sense. So hopefully at the end of today's talk, what you'll have is some appreciation not only of what a heart attack is, but some appreciation as to how to compare heart attack definitions or any definitions. So if I'm going too fast or not making sense, please stop me. I might just start off. I like this saying. This encapsulates to me what crisis is all about. We're living longer, but are we necessarily living healthier? Nothing more so in things like cancer and cardiac. And I think that should be the focus of a crisis benefit. The cancer and cardiac are the common things. In medicine, there's a term, common things occur commonly. So let's talk about some of the most common things in here. I break up crisis cardiac definitions into categories, and I think it makes sense, helps you understand it as well. There's things that block the blood supply to the heart, so that's heart attacks or strokes, whether it's the heart or the brain, or else the procedure used in its treatment, bypass surgery, angioplasty. Conditions where surgery is required to repair the heart, so that's heart valve surgery or surgery to the aorta. In conditions where there's sort of pressure changes, which is cardiomyopathy, where the heart is failing, or pulmonary hypertension, where the heart's just put too much pressure into your lungs and it's quite a serious condition. So that's a really easy way to work that, what different benefit types they are. We're going to concentrate on heart attack just because it's a talk about heart attacks, so we'll concentrate on heart attacks. But I'm going to give you a little bit of a case study because I like case studies. I think they're relevant. This is actually one that came through on my desk. You've got a 55-year-old high net client, long-standing. Brother recently had a heart attack and he's going into a new business venture. So he wants to make sure he's protected to the max. You've got a new person in your dealership, and your advisor, as they often do, say, it's not, why are you doing this? We've got a much better heart attack definition in the old place that we were working at. Why don't we use that? So she actually shows you this heart attack definition. Who can have a little look at that and say they understand what's being said over there? Apart from you, sir, who you have been a claimant yourself, is there anybody else? It's all gobbledygook, so start going. And I might just echo Michael as well. I don't like comparing to other competitors. I think we stand alone and we don't need to compare. This is actually is a constructed definition. It's not any other competitor's definition. So here we go. Heart attack means the death of a portion of a heart muscle, a result of inadequate blood supply to the relevant area. Diagnosis is going to be supported by two of the following. New ECG changes, rise and fall of this thing called a troponin, new pathological changes, this thing where we want to see a reduction in the cardiac ejection fraction of 50% 3 months after the event. And at our discretion, we'll consider other tests. Who's feeling the love here? Anyone understand that one? Sorry, sir, do you mind if you just wait? I'll just get the... Thank you.
To these seminars, and lately the fashion is that these definitions of passive heart attack. I haven't heard of heart attack myself, but what is a passive heart attack? Passive heart attack. I've just been asked on seminar lately that, you know, that actually they were explaining about the cover of a passive heart attack in the pulse.
I'm not really sure what a passive heart attack, maybe it's a heart attack when you're not exercising or, I'm not really sure. There's a thing called a silent heart attack, is that kind of what you're thinking of? I might just come to that. There's different types of heart attacks. You can have heart attacks where you actually know you're having a heart attack. Then you have a heart attack when you actually don't know you're having a heart attack. And that's in particularly diabetics. And diabetics don't necessarily have the same pain sensation because of their diabetes. So you find out they've had a heart attack sometime in the past because you've done an investigation. So that's called a silent heart attack. I'm presuming that's probably what it is, passive. But perhaps we can go through the session, and if it still doesn't make sense, we can talk afterwards. So I'll tell you what, how many here think that's a good definition or bad definition? What sort of criteria do you utilize? There's a lot of sideways shaking of the heads. No, Confusing? What would you do in a situation like this? How would you recommend something to one of your clients? Sir?
Explaining that to the client.
Yeah.
Now, if we as advisors or whatever, right, right. It's very hard just to understand that and to explain to that. It's just a lot of, I shouldn't say this in a bad way, mumbo-jumbo jargon.
Very technical, isn't it?
Yeah, very.
Yep. But how would you say this is better than Astron or CommInsure or Macquarie's is better than AIA?
Very hard. Very yep. hard, yeah.
Has anyone else got any perspectives on what they do when they actually have this conundrum? Do you go to the rating houses and just break it down and say, no? Yeah, everyone's sitting on the fence, are they? Bad spot for your prostates, gentlemen. Heart attack definition. It's still googly-gook, isn't it? Well, let's face it, oh, this is our definition. That's my microphone. It's still very technical. And I think one of the problems the industry has had is that we've not made it easy for either the claimant, either the prospective client, or the advisor to understand why it is. Now, that heart attack definition that you see over here came out in 2008 in AIA. About 4 months ago, one of the rating houses we were very grateful for looked at it and they said, we don't think you've got a really good heart attack definition for these reasons, and they gave us the opportunity to respond to that. We responded to that, and then as a result of that, we went up to an A, and everyone else went down to a different category, to B. Nothing had changed in the 4 years between when our definition came out to when they re-looked at it. So why is the difference? Part of the problem is it's very technical, and unless you get some understanding of what this is, it's going to be really hard to understand why this is better than anything else, why this should be pursued as opposed to something else. So I'm going to just leave this for you as a reference. We've got a definition up here. We've got some things that we want to do, and I'm going to focus on this thing called the 99th percentile because we've led the pack and there are other people following us. You're going to see exactly the same terminology in a whole range of other insurers in the future. And if you don't understand ours, I think you might struggle to understand some of the others as well. So we're going to spend a bit of time just deciphering some of the googly-gook. And so here's some of the criteria. Here's something else that says we'll consider other appropriate tests. And here's an exclusion that we have in place. So just going straight back into what our definitions. Again, I like thinking in categories and in groups, and I break up any definition into three primary events, so three separate events. There's a primary definition, there's a secondary or alternative definition, and there's an exclusion. Every crisis definition, you can apply exactly that methodology to get it. Something actually talks about how are we going to make the primary definition up. How do we know it's a heart attack? What exactly makes it a heart attack? What makes it a stroke? What makes it multiple sclerosis? There's got to be some sort of definition that helps us. Those definitions are broken down into a few categories. You've got clinical criteria, and that's just so the doctor knows what we're talking about, medicos know what we're talking about. It defines that there's got to be a certain range of things that need to be done. There's a severity criteria, and this is a bit more of an insurance construct. So we might say, yeah, you've got a heart attack. But we're not going to pay just any old heart attack. We're not going to pay a silent heart attack. We only want to make sure that you absolutely deserve this by having a bad heart attack. Or we might say, you know, so what? You've got prostate cancer. Big deal. We want to make sure that your prostate cancer is so bad, you need to have your prostate taken out before we say you'll fulfill the intent of what we're doing. Yeah? So there's an insurance construct. Oh, beg your pardon. There's an insurance construct, and it's got some clinical criteria to put down against it. We will not pay unless you have stage T2, blah, 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 blah. Then there's an insurance criteria, which says we have to have certain things, absolutely need certain things, and then there's a choice of other things that you need. So if you've got a definition that needs you to fulfill 10 things, it's obviously nowhere near as generous as a definition that says, you know what, you fulfill one and maybe one of the two others and you only need two things and that's it. Yeah? So that's again, applicable right across crisis definitions. The secondary definition is sort of the fairness definition. It says sometimes it's not going to be captured by the primary definition. You might have something that just steps a bit outside of the primary definition. Let's be fair. We have to be fair, right? So we do a secondary definition. Now, the intent is to pick up the fact there's new tests, there's atypical presentations. But the secondary definition is also being constructed with these sorts of parameters in place. Clinical criteria, so it specifies what you might need clinically. It might also have a severity criteria. It might have what's called an equivalency criteria. And that previous definition that we talked about, I'll just quickly go back to. At our discretion, we will consider any other medical test provided by a cardiologist that unequivocally diagnoses myocardial infarction to the degree of severity or greater as documented above. Now, I'm a doctor. I'm struggling to work out how you do that. That's an equivalency rating. So it's saying we're still going to say you have to have a severe degree of impairment before we're going to pay this benefit. The last one is obviously the exclusions, and the exclusions just very clearly. We want to make sure when a claim comes in, we're not toing and froing, we're not going back, we're not unfulfilling the expectations of the person putting it in. So we try to make sure and say, you're not going to get this. If you're in this category, that's definitely out. Nice and clearly explained. I'm going to run an animation of just what the heart does, just to give us a bit of an idea on it and to break up the monotony of my voice. Andreas, do you mind playing the animation, please?
We'll start with the basics and examine how the human heart works. The heart is a muscle about the size of a clenched fist that is located under the rib cage and between the lungs. It is divided into a left side and a right side. Each side has two chambers. The upper chambers are called atria, and the lower chambers are called ventricles. Blood flows from the atria to the ventricles through one-way valves. The atria and the ventricles work together as a team to pump blood through the heart. The right atrium receives oxygen-depleted blood from the body and pushes it into the right ventricle, which pumps it out to the lungs. Oxygen-enriched blood is returned from the lungs to the left atrium, which pushes it into the left ventricle, where it is pumped back out to the body. After the body has used all of the oxygen in the blood returns to the heart and the cycle repeats. In a normal heart, this sequence occurs 60 to 100 times per minute. The heart's beating rhythms are driven by electrical impulses within the heart. In a normal heart rhythm, electrical signals originate in the heart's natural pacemaker, the sinoatrial node, also called the SA node. These electrical signals travel from the atria to the ventricles in a defined rhythmic pattern. The electrical signals pass through the atrioventricular, or AV, node. The AV node acts as a natural gatekeeper for the heart, through which all the heart's electrical signals...
My apologies, it cuts out for some reason. I haven't been able to fix it. The reason I put it up, I want you to have a bit of an understanding as to how the heart works, because that is directly going to influence the investigations that you take for the heart. So if the heart has had a death of it, which is what a heart attack is, heart muscle dies, it's not going to pump really efficiently. There are going to be areas that don't pump well. Similarly, the electrical conduction then gets a bit skewed because that's a dead part of the heart. And an ECG is just a test where they put electrodes on your chest, and what they're doing is they're measuring the electricity within the heart. When you have a heart attack, you have differing changes of electricity, and those are characteristically seen, and that is what the ECG changes and the definition pertain to. All right, heart attacks. Lots of things cause you heart attacks. This is a really great place. I want to visit it. It's in Las Vegas. It's called the Heart Attack Grill. This is called the Triple Bypass Burger. It's a quadruple bypass burger. And funnily enough, not that long ago, a man had a heart attack whilst he was in the Heart Attack Grill. I actually wanted to put the picture of the waitresses walk around dressed as nurses in skimpy outfits, and the owner walks around with a stethoscope. But unfortunately, our legal department's not the funnest guys in the world, and they didn't feel it was appropriate showing skimpily clad women. But heart attacks have a history before it, obviously. There's factors, there's genetics, there's lifestyle risk factors, and they all come about, and they all increase your risk. And that's what the underwriters look at when you have an application coming through. They'll look at what is the risk of somebody of this age, this sex, with all these factors, what is the chances of them having a heart attack? So I've been told I have very busy slides, so after this series of lectures I'm doing a TAFE course on how to make relaxed PowerPoint slides. But I don't want anyone to just get too caught up with the wording in here. I'd rather just talk some of these issues through. The same problem that we said, how do people know that you're having a heart attack, is a problem that clinicians have. How does one doctor particularly say you're having a heart attack and another doctor might not think you're necessarily having a heart attack? They might think you're having angina, which is the stage before the heart attack. So in 2007, nearly every major cardiac association in the developed world banded together with the WHO to make what's called the universal definition of myocardial infarct. They said, we want to make sure that every cardiologist and doctor are working off the same parameters of what constitutes a heart attack so there's no confusion by anyone. Essentially, you can see, looks pretty familiar, doesn't it? It's pretty much AIA's definition. This came out in 2007, and in 2008, AIA's definition changed. The intent was to mirror the intent of what we said. If you have a heart attack, we want to pay your benefit. We don't want any problems in working out whether you had a heart attack or not. So it pretty much mirrored everything. Rise and fall cardiac biomarkers with at least one value above the 99th percentile up the upper range, together with evidence of myocardial ischemia. Ischemia meaning reduced blood supply to the heart cell. Symptoms, ECG changes, imaging changes. Very similar to the AIA's definition, because this is what it was based on 4 years ago. I'm going to run an animation now of what exactly a heart attack is, just so you understand what it is. Do you mind running it, please?
The heart is responsible for pumping oxygen-rich blood to the rest of the body, providing the energy that the body needs to function. The muscles of the heart itself also need a supply of blood. The coronary arteries, one of which we see here, fill that need. Sometimes a cholesterol plaque forms on the side of the artery, reducing blood flow. If part of that plaque breaks through into the artery, platelets tend to attach to it, creating a blood clot, further reducing or blocking blood flow. The blockage in the artery prevents blood from reaching part of the heart muscle. Without blood, the muscle is starved for oxygen, causing damage to the heart muscle. The heart attack occurs because the damaged heart can no longer pump properly.
The key to having a heart attack is you have to have death of a heart muscle. If you don't have death of a heart muscle, it becomes what's called angina. When heart muscle dies, it releases a cardiac biomarker, which is a particular measurable enzyme that's in the bloodstream that you can measure by taking a blood test. The most sensitive of these is a thing called troponins. It takes a little while for this troponin to be measurable in your blood. So if I come to you 2 hours, or maybe if you come to me, I'm the doctor, I forgot that. If you come to me 2 hours after you started having chest pain and I do a blood test for you, that's going to be negative for troponin because it's not measurable. And that's why quite often you might have relatives or friends, they go to hospital, they're not quite sure, they're kept in hospital for a period of time, and what the doctors do, they test you at, say, hour number 5, they test you at hour number 10, they want to make sure whether or not you are having a heart attack. If the test at hour number 10 is negative, you're not having a heart attack, you're sent home. Right? The idea is you try to get as much intervention as early as possible to prevent the death of the heart muscle. You don't want to let somebody go 20 hours before you do something. You want to know as early as you can to prevent more heart muscle from dying. So those definitions which specify a troponin threshold are really actually putting a severity criteria in it. They're saying for you to get 2.0 nanograms per microliter, you have to knock off a fair bit of heart. Right? So just having a threshold automatically specified puts a severity criteria onto that. When I started doing medicine, and I was actually a graduate from Sydney University at St. George Hospital, it was really, really challenging to work out if somebody with chest pain if they presented with chest pain, whether they were having a heart attack or not. The tests like troponin weren't readily available, and you had to do all manners of things to work out whether they were having a heart attack, and some of them were quite dangerous. If you gave them little drugs to dissolve the clot, you could, in fact, trigger off a stroke. You can trigger off bleeding in other areas. So there was a great deal of nervousness when you weren't terribly sure they're having a heart attack. I vividly remember one man who came in after eating some satay chicken, and he had a, everything pointed to the fact that he had a heart attack. He had all the right chest symptoms. He had an ECG that looked like he was having a heart attack. And then his daughter came up to me and said, "Look, I don't know if Dad's really got a heart attack, but he was really eating that satay." It ended up he had actually eaten the satay stick with the stick intact and had perforated his esophagus. And I put a chest tube into his chest and all the satay chicken just kept draining out. Now, I could have killed that man by giving him some clot-dissolving drugs in the time when his esophagus was bleeding and open and wide. Troponins has made an enormous difference to the measurement of heart attacks. The new troponins are getting so sensitive, they're not even sure whether you're having a heart attack because nobody knows what normal is. They're so sensitive, they're picked up. There's certain conditions where troponins exist, but you're not having a heart attack. They're cardiac conditions where they might exist. In chronic renal failure, they might exist. So the only way you know somebody in that situation is having a heart attack is you see this rise and fall of the troponin because it goes back to its baseline. So they run along with a troponin level like this. They have a heart attack. Their heart cells release troponin. It goes up, and as the heart cells stop dying, the troponin release tapers off. And that's the reason for this terminology, rise and or fall. It's in the market. A few of our other competitors are saying that their definitions have rise and or fall in it, and so it's better. It's really a point of differentiation trying to find some relevance. It makes no difference really on that, and I'll explain why later. I'll just go back. The 99th percentile, you saw that in the terminology. Troponin needs to be above the 99th percentile. Who thinks that's pretty hard? 99 is a pretty high number, right? So getting it above the 99th percentile means you must be really, really bad. Is that what you think? Is it bad, easy? Anyone awake? Who thinks it's bad? Mitchell, you think it's good. You see, I went through medicine saying if you got 51% in an exam, that's one lecture too many. So 99 for me is really, really high. Yeah? Anyone thinks it's low? I want some severe commitment, guys. Hands up who thinks it's low. Who thinks it's high? Sorry, I beg your pardon?
Should be 100.
Should be 100? This has caused so much confusion. I can't tell you how many inquiries I get through on my desk from advisors who say, what the hell does 99 percentile mean? And I can't tell you how many inquiries I get from our own sales staff saying, can you explain this 99th percentile again to me? Very confusing. Hopefully we'll be able to navigate our way through it. The 99th percentile is nothing but a statistical mark. Right? If I line up everyone in a height, it's called a standard distribution. There's going to be some people over here are short, some people over here, not me, but some people over here are going to be tall, and in the middle is the vast number of people, and that's the average, right? So in a normal population, you get this bell-shaped curve. And when you do tests, you have to say, well, we think this is normal and we think the outside of this is abnormal, right? So what they do is they do a construct that says two standard deviations, so a particular mathematical term, if you go out of there, you will cover 95% of people in two standard deviations. So lab tests will say, we're going to measure this. We're going to call everyone within two standard deviations normal. We're going to call the people outside of two standard deviations abnormal. Now, 5% of people are going to be normal, but because their value steps outside of that particular line, they're considered abnormal. The universal definition author said, we're not comfortable that there's going to be potentially people who aren't going to be picked up if we consider this 95%. So they say, we're going to push it out to here, which is nearly three standard deviations. So we want to make sure that anybody who has a troponin within this value is normal, and anybody who has a troponin value outside of that is indicating a heart attack. So it is nothing except just a decision making. It's got no biological meaning. It's just the people saying, we want to make sure that we're capturing everyone who's normal. So I tell you what, anyone who has a value that's outside of normal is above the 99th percentile, and by that definition is having a heart attack if they fulfill the other criteria. So we looked at that previous definition, and I think that definition said your troponin T needed to be 0.6 nanogram per litre. To be above the 99th percentile, you need to be 0.03. This is a very, very, very generous definition. It means that there are a lot of people who are being picked up who 10, 15 years ago, because their tests weren't so sensitive, would have been sent home to be saying, you've got a bit of angina, you know, why don't you do some lifestyle factors and you'll be all right. They're now being diagnosed as having a heart attack. So by us mirroring this, we have dramatically increased the catchment of people who are being diagnosed as having heart attack. There is no severity criteria inherent at all in that definition, because we're saying you've been diagnosed, diagnosis equals payment. Chest pain's another thing. I can't tell you how many times people have said to me, well, our competitors said to me, you pay for chest pain. I mean, that's so easy to mimic. It's so easy to fake. Chest pain, putting that in there, not everyone has chest pain, so why are you going to put it in there? Chest pain is probably the way that somebody knows that they're having a heart attack, right? You're not going to turn up to the hospital and say, I think I'm having a passive heart attack there. I don't know what's wrong with me, but I think I'm having a heart attack. Chest pain is a classical one, but sometimes you get what they call atypical. It's not usual. You might come up with pain in your jaw. You might come up with pain in your hand. I'm not sure how you present it, sir, but you know, if you turned up, you could have a whole range of symptoms there. Dude, we pay for that. Chest pain is actually seen in 60 to 70% of presentations for heart attack. That's pretty common. And I don't care who you are. I think it's really, really hard to fake chest pain, a troponin rise, and ECG changes. Yeah. So it's a bit of a nonsensical. We were the only people that went into the market and said, you know what, we're going to pick up chest pain. It's an important part. The universal definition says this is a really important facet of having a heart attack. So we put it in there. And again, for 4 years, no other insurance company really gave due credit, I suppose, for chest pain. And ECG changes. I don't want to go through. This is very technical stuff. There's a couple of things I want to just you to take home. Not every heart attack can be diagnosed off an ECG. Why? Certain heart attacks are so mild they don't get the classical changes. A lot of people already have abnormal ECGs. So how do you read an abnormal ECG before the event? Very difficult. There is one particular term called a Q wave, and I'll just draw attention to the Q wave. That's sort of a de facto severity criteria, because if you've knocked off all of your heart wall muscles, so the whole thickness is gone, you usually get a Q wave. And if you don't get a Q wave, it usually means that you've knocked off maybe a little bit of your muscle, not the full thickness, as a general rule of thumb. So policies that specify having Q wave in there are, again, doing the same thing, putting a severity criteria onto it. Q waves are part of the ECG, but there's plenty of conditions. Sorry, Q waves are part of the diagnosis of heart attacks. But there are plenty of conditions where you can get Q waves, so it's quite difficult. And you know what? Chest pain, ECGs, my father's a doctor. I don't think that has changed since my father started practicing medicine a long time before man walked the moon. Medicine has certainly changed. We've got a definition that says we look at ECGs and we look at symptoms. But there's a bucket load of other things that medicine has done that helps us work out whether or not you've had a heart attack. Some of those things are things like nuclear medicine tests. These are lovely little things. This is sort of the lava lamps of the clinical world. You give a person a nice little radioactive marker. Bits of heart muscle that's supplied by blood take up this radioactive marker and it starts glowing. It's this really relaxing glow. I used to love just falling asleep to it on long ICU nights. The bits of the heart that doesn't actually have any blood flow to it don't take up the marker, so they don't glow. So you can work out. It's a really useful test, very sensitive test. So you can actually work out a silent heart attack later on because you might see this fixed abnormality coming through. Echocardiographies are ultrasounds of your heart, and I'll just quickly touch on that in the next slide because a lot of policies actually specify you need to have an ultrasound or echo. And then there's cardiac MRIs, which I think are going to be the way forward, but they're so expensive. I don't think it's going to be anytime soon that we'll be doing it standard. But cardiac MRIs give nearly everything every other test do. Other tests might do it better, but no one test does everything that those tests all do. So it's a really exciting way to move forward. Very quickly, this is a busy slide. An echo in what we do, cardiac heart attack definitions sometimes put in this thing called an ejection fraction. And an ejection fraction is just saying heart pumps out, like we saw in that animation. In the left ventricle, the heart pumps out blood, but not all of the blood goes out. So about 55 to 70% of what's in the ventricle gets pumped out with every beat. Yeah? When you knock off a large portion of your heart muscle, you're not efficiently pumping. So the ejection fraction drops. You're only pumping out less than normal, less than 50%. So again, putting 50% in there or less means that we want to see that you've knocked off a large part of your heart. But you have to wait 3 months, because in the first 3 months after you have a heart attack, you go through a normal healing process and your ejection fraction can actually be a bit depressed, but it might come back later. And I think it's quite unfair to be asking somebody who's had a heart attack to wait 3 months, have a test that doesn't necessarily have to happen for their clinical care, just so they can fulfill a definition. But that's the basis of it. All right, so if I could just go back, everything in red is what I just think are severity criteria that's been put into the definition. I'm not saying it's good or bad, I'm just saying here's how it works. Two, so you're asking for criteria. Troponin in excess of 2 or troponin T in excess of 0.6. As we said, 0.03 is, you got 0.04, you're in the above the 99th percentile. Pathological Q waves, ejection fractions 50% or less, measured 3 months, permanent. At our discretion, I don't particularly like that, at our discretion. But anyway, at our discretion, we will consider a test, but it needs to show unequivocally to the degree documented above. I don't know what test would allow you to show that, quite frankly, but here it is. The AIA secondary definition, the alternative definition, is what I call the hug anybody definition. We don't particularly care what test you are got. You send us a test that shows us that you've had a heart attack, we will be able to take it. That covers imaging, that covers clinical, that covers a whole range of parameters. Yeah. So we have a very, very generous secondary definition that we deliberately put in there. And again, all of this predated my involvement with the company, but I understand it was put in there with the understanding that medicine evolves, new tests come into play. Our definition can't specify each and every new test that's coming on back, so we wanted to future-proof it. So it was put, all the imaging things were covered within that category of we'll see any other medically recognized tests. We're nearly finished. Thank you for your patience, everyone. I just thought maybe this might help define some of the cases you might get. You know, somebody comes in with chest pain, they've got an elevated troponin, ECG is not really diagnostic. AIA's definition would pay on the first primary definition assessment. This one wouldn't. You'd have to go to other tests to work it out. Similarly, you might present late, which is quite common. You might show troponin that's decreasing value, and you might have pre-existing ECG changes. Again, we would pay because we have this wonderful thing about the clinical symptoms in there. So I might just give you this, why we think we had a great definition and why we think we had a great definition 4 years ago and we still think we got a great definition now. It's because we have a primary definition that very closely mirrors the clinical. Now, clinical definitions, as I mentioned, don't worry about severity. They're worried about have you got it or have you not got it. If you got it, we'll pay it. If you haven't got it, we're not going to pay it unless you prove you got it. Yeah? We have no severity criteria. We have just one mandatory and a couple of options, so not terribly high a bar to fulfill. We've got the hug anybody catch-all definition, and we really clearly define exclusions, which sometimes can be a problem. You can sometimes have a heart attack because you've gone to have treatment. So you might have bypass surgery, and because of the bypass surgery, you've had a heart attack. You've had a worsening of your heart attack. Does anyone know what an angioplasty is? I'm not just pointing at my groin for fun. Now, angioplasty is when they put a little wire up through the groin, thread a little needle, it's really quite clever. And it goes up to the heart, and the heart is supplied by arteries, right? So they thread this little needle through there, and then they inject some dye into the arteries, and they take an x-ray picture. And the x-ray picture will show you just how much narrowing they've got in the arteries. Yeah? Again, when I said to you, nowadays the focus is on trying to prevent people having a heart attack by intervening early so they can reduce the amount of heart muscle. In most tertiary hospitals, they've got teams that are on standby. So if somebody comes in with a heart attack, they actually take them into theatre and they do an angiogram to work out where it's being blocked. While the person's having a heart attack, they'll put a little metal tube across the obstruction or they'll blow it up with a balloon. Now, the act of actually doing an angioplasty, you can have another heart attack. Right? But it's revolutionized how you treat medicine because it's stopped people having severe heart attacks. But we don't worry about all of that. We say, we don't pay for angina. Angina isn't a heart attack because nothing's died. We pay for a heart attack. And other people do some quite severe exclusions out there. So, again, this just probably summarizes what that tabular form showed. We think we've got a good definition. We've shown our intents years ago before anybody else even moved from it. That was the category most people had severity, it had restrictions. The AA definition was so far ahead of that. Now there's other people, obviously, who have recognized that somewhat belatedly, that we do have a very generous definition, and they've tried to improve on it. We're really talking about points of differentiation that don't exist, really. As I've explained there, we pay a heart attack. In the 2.5 years I've been here, I see every crisis claim coming through. I've got no problem. We do not stop a genuine heart attack coming through, and we don't make it difficult for the patient, gotta get that out of my mind, the claimant who puts it in to make a heart attack. That's pretty much it. I'll put my disclaimer. I do no medical advice. Anyone have any questions? I'm more than happy to field any questions. Could I just ask in here, please? Just gentleman's got a question. Thank you.
Just on the example that you just illustrated about angioplasty.
Mm-hmm.
When the angioplasty is applied and it causes a heart attack.
It can cause it.
Is that claimable under the AAA policy?
Yes.
It is.
So it's not excluded.
Thank you. Just could we get copies of these slides, please?
We do anything. Yeah. Absolutely. And if you need to speak to me on any particular, I'm outside later as well. Does anyone have any confusion? Has that made it clearer, not clearer?
Yeah. In other words, you pay even a minor heart attack.
You know, here's it. I'm actually going to forget about any distinction of minor, major. I'm just going to say we pay heart attacks. Yeah? That is the only criteria you need to have. You need to have a heart attack, and we pay it. Yeah. Sorry, just in the back.
Do you have any thoughts around the industry considering standard definitions across the major critical illness events?
Instinctively, it appeals to me. I'm talking completely outside of my role in AIA as an external person who's come into the industry. I believe in the UK it's standardised, and what you do is you compete on pricing, you compete on service, and you compete on a whole range of other things, but the definition remains the same. What I'd like and what the industry is going to go as is two widely divergent pathways. I think it is extraordinarily difficult, I think, for a claimant to understand what the hell is going on to them when they have to navigate that. When I first came around and had to look at the different competitors, I was gobsmacked. It was so complicated.
Yeah. The concern I've got is from an advisor point of view, and I think I've had three instances where a claim's been denied under a certain definition, whereas under another company's definition that was available at the same time, the claim would have succeeded.
You know, again, we've got the opportunity here to pitch AIA, and I'm going to pitch AIA because you're going to have, more likely than not, one of your clients have a cancer or have a heart problem, yeah? Common things will occur commonly. You might be fortunate to have somebody who has mad cow disease. Good luck to you. That's probably 1 in 10,000. You will have 9,500 people exposed to cancer or cardiac, and you want to make sure that they're covered for those ones. And even if we perhaps don't move to a setting where all the definitions are the same, it would be really great that the heart attack and the cardiac definitions remain the same. But that's obviously a risk appetite. There's a pricing issue to it. There's a whole manners of things that go, not just the medical side.
Does an angina attack always precede a heart attack?
There's always a period before you kill heart muscle. Yeah, so it's like getting a stitch, and the stitch is the angina. So you have to have some degree of it, but it could be like you're having the angina here and it's progressed to a heart attack within 20 minutes or 10 minutes. But not all angina cases have to go to become heart attacks.
if they're repaired by angioplasty.
No, even without that, you don't necessarily have. You might have angina, and your angina is only when you do your marathon. In which case, most doctors would turn around and say, you've got stable angina. We know that when you exert yourself, your heart's asking for extra blood flow, and the narrowing in the heart artery, the coronary arteries, isn't sufficient. But you know what? You're unlikely to be having to do a marathon every time, so you're stable. We're going to give you tablets. We're going to manage you with tablets. Other people have unstable angina, where you might be sitting down watching a funny show and you laugh too hard and your heart starts spasming because you're laughing hard. That's a bit of a different story. That's very close to having a heart attack, so that's taken and treated in a different way.
What about cardiomyopathy? Where does that all fit in?
Yeah, no, cardiomyopathy, if you recall the first slide where I break them up, cardiomyopathy is a dilated or heart or abnormally functioning heart, and there are many reasons you can have it. We pay a benefit for cardiomyopathy. You can have it because you like the grog too much and you're drinking and you get alcoholic cardiomyopathy. You can get a cardiomyopathy because you've got a genetic problem and it's passed on and your heart fails. Cardiomyopathies can be quite serious, and the treatment for them usually eventually is a heart transplant, generally, but not all the time.
Given AIA has had this definition for 4 years longer than the majority of other competitors.
Oh, there you are. Sorry, there's a voice in the mail.
Sorry, what's the claims experience been like over those last 4 years compared to the competitors?
I don't really know what the competitors do, so I'm not really sure. We paid quite a few claims, but you know, we write a lot of business. There's no really comparators that I can turn around and say, we pay 100 in the last 2 years and Astron has paid 2. Instinctively, I'll tell you, we pay a bucket load more than our competitors do just because of all those factors that we run through. And again, we don't differentiate minor and major. That's the issue, I suppose. Might just take one last question, if that's all right.
Question on insertion of stents.
Yep.
I had a situation just recently where a client was identified as having 3 blockages. The surgeon corrected 2.
Yes.
And decided not to do the third on a risk management type basis.
Right.
And the fact that it was not as severe as the others. The definition said we'll pay a partial on 2 and we'll pay a full benefit on 3.
Yes.
Providing all 3 are done in the same procedure. So we went back to the provider and said, well, what happens if symptoms remain and the surgeon says we need to then go in and correct a third? They said, well, sorry, no claim.
Yeah, I think that's a bit of bloody-minded adherence to the letter of the wording rather than looking at the intent. That person has got a disease, and I think it fulfills the intent of what you're trying to do. But I can't... It wasn't us, was it?
No.
Thank God. Thank you very much, everyone. If you would like to have any other questions, I'm more than happy to do it in the break. Thank you for your time.